Barak and the Wurundjeri people. In olden times, when the Wurundjeri lived throughout the Yarra Valley and platypus families lived the length of the river, Barak was born by the banks of Bushy Creek under the shade of the gum trees. He was the youngest of six children of Babajan and Tuteri. The boy was born to be Narangita, or headman of the Wurundjeri, like his father before him, and as he lay gurgling in his mother's arms, no one would have foreseen the changes that were ahead. Barak grew up a happy, quiet little boy, and he loved to listen as his elders told stories of the land, its birds and animals, and taught him the ways of the Wurundjeri people. He knew he must care for the land as he travelled about according to the seasons, and he learnt to live alongside nature, under the watchful eye of Bunjil the eagle, the creator of all. In August, when the wattle blossomed and the flowers floated down to settle on the slowly flowing Yarra, eels would appear and it would be time for feasting and celebrating. Barak remembered times as a child when he and his cousins would gorge themselves on the fatty barbecued eels, then roll around for hours in the grass, groaning because they had eaten too much. He heard stories of the white fellas that had arrived to the north when his father was still a boy, and he saw the steel axe, his father's prized possession, that had been bartered down along Aboriginal trade routes from Port Jackson, along with the stories. He watched with his father as sailing boats arrived in Port Phillip Bay, and he saw the sealers and whalers, and he knew that some had taken his cousins away to have for their wives. But things were different when John Batman arrived, for he meant to settle. No longer would the white man just come and go. "This will be a place for a village," said Batman. But Barak was not happy, for it was his favourite camping place on the river. He knew where a platypus family lived at that camping place, and he loved to lie in the grass by the banks of the Yarra River near Birrarungma and watch in the early dawn as the platypus family busied itself about the creek. His father told him, "That platypus, fussy little fella, he only camped where the water very clean. You look for platypus, Barak. He your special animal." That's why he grew sad. When Batman came, the platypus family left that spot and headed upstream. Barak was 12 when he attended the big meeting by the river with his father and other elders, and he watched in amazement when Batman unpacked all his trade items and set them before the crowd of Aboriginal people. Barak couldn't believe it. There were 100 tomahawks. Why, his father's axe had been precious and revered all through his early childhood because of its rarity. And now, here was 100. There were blankets, clothes, scissors, looking glasses, and 5 tons of flour. When Barak told his mother about the large amount of flour they had been given, she couldn't believe it. Why, it took hours to grind enough flour from wattle seeds to make cake to feed her family. And here, there were many, many bags of flour, her son had told her. Batman had the chiefs make their mark on a piece of paper with writing. He called it a treaty, and he said now this was his land. Barak had thought they were gifts, and it wasn't till years later that he understood what had happened that day. For a few trinkets and baubles, Batman believed he had bought the land. Along with other youngsters of his people, Barak crowded around the settlers, looking for gifts and other strange items. It was exciting times for the young boy. Not long after, his family was forced away from their camping spot near the newly proclaimed city of Melbourne, and Barak and his people were moved away from his father's country. Year after year, they were marched to places that were set aside to the Aboriginal people. But sometimes they were too cold, or there was not good bush tucker, and sometimes they could feel evil spirits about. Barak understood. His people were not happy, and fighting took place between the new settlers and the Wurundjeri, and some of his cousins died. Other members of his family were dying of disease and sadness. Barak listened as his uncle, Billy Bileri, and his cousin Wonga talked with the governors. Our people are dying. We need to go back to our father's country and we need rations. One more time we will move, and we want in writing from the governor this land belonged to the Aboriginal people for all time. And so Barak and the remnants of his once proud nation moved to a place near Hillsville. Bilibileri suggested the name Korundurk for the new settlement, the Wurundjeri word for the pretty little Christmas bush that grew all about. The small party set about building homes and planting crops like they had done so many times before. After his uncle died, Barak stood alongside his cousin Wonga to lead their people. When his cousin died, he became the Nurungita and chief of the Wurundjeri or Yarra Yarra tribe. It was while at Korundurk and growing old that Barak started to paint. He had decided he would paint the stories of his land and its law so that people would know about the Wurundjeri people and their customs long after he had gone. Often he painted ceremonies of his childhood, men standing tall in decorated possum skin rugs, clapping together their boomerangs, women beating on rolled up skins, the rhythm to which the men danced. Barak always included animals in his paintings so people would know the special nature of Wurundjeri land. Now that the white man had his cows and sheep and had disrespectfully cut down the trees and dirtied the water, how long would his beloved native flora and fauna remain? He painted it all, tribal councils, corroborees, and the journeys his people had been forced to take. Sometimes Barak would wander up and down the Yarra looking for his friend, the platypus, and it saddened him that, like his people, there were not many of the furry little creatures left living along the banks of the river. Overhead, old Bunjil screeched and wailed. He too was sad at the changing ways. But his people were happy at Korundurk for a while, until it was decided that once again they would need to move on to different lands. Barak was not happy, and he went to see the governor. Long ago he had promised to look after Wurundjeri people. He told the governor, "You've got to know your father's country. Yarra is my father's country. Me no leave it. Yarra my father's country. There's no mountains for me on the Murray." Some people helped Barak along the way. One was Mrs. Anne Bond, a feisty red-headed Scotswoman. When she was newly married, aside her husband she met Barak and his wife Lizzie, and the couples were to become firm friends. Mrs. Bond and Barak grieved together when they both lost their partners and a child. She learnt about Aboriginal culture by listening to the old storyteller and his tales of boyhood and the ways of his people. He had a gentle way of speaking and was known to captivate any audience. Mrs. Bond stood alongside Barak and together they fought for Aboriginal rights. There is a tree that grows in Barak's homelands, and it is known as the Wurundjeri wattle. And over the centuries, the Aboriginal people discovered many and varied uses for the wattle. Barak always said it was the best wood for a boomerang. Find the right bend in a wattle branch and you had yourself the makings of a fine hunting tool. Since the white settlers had arrived, it seems to have taken on additional meaning. For as the elders of his people died, Barak observed that it was always at the time the wattle was in bloom. Barak's father died when the wattle was in flower down by the Yarra River near the Melbourne Zoo, and every year at the same time would visit that place. Aboriginal people have now come to associate the wattle with death. He too knew when his time was come, and he told his friends that he would be dead before the wattle bloomed again. And so he died on the 15th of August, 1903. As his good friend Anne Bond said, "The wind in the trees, the birds on the wing, the rain as it falls, sad tidings they bring. Barak is gone, is gone.